Melbourne reporter Christine Ahern leads our coverage, and Chris, misbehaving security guards were not initially to blame for the second wave.
Well, initially, Ali, that's right, because patient zero has been identified as a night duty manager here at Ridges on Swanston Street. This is according to a report in The Age this morning. So leaked emails show that on the 25th of May, that night manager started to show symptoms. The next day, the department was notified that that night manager had tested positive. Seven security guards considered close contacts were immediately stood down, told to self-isolate and get tested. But by then, it was already too late because five of them tested positive to COVID-19, and by then they'd already spread it to their families and out in the community in the north and west. It's not clear how this hotel employee contracted the virus, but it is presumed that they got it from a returned traveller who was quarantining here. As the fight between the federal and Victorian governments continues over just what ADF support was on offer and when it comes to hotel quarantine, there's a new twist in that as well, because revelations this morning that meetings at the State Control Centre where decisions were made on the quarantine operation were actually routinely recorded. So those recordings are set to form part of the judicial inquiry, which is currently underway. And the military is set to get more powers when it comes to national emergencies like pandemics, with the federal government planning to amend the Defence Act. Ali.
Some major developments this morning. Thank you, Chris. Some 3AW's Neil Mitchell has called on Daniel Andrews to come clean about the hotel quarantine debacle as the blame game drags on. He spoke on the show a little earlier, saying the Victorian Premier is losing the public's trust.
People are copying it and they're doing it because they know they have to, and they're a resilient lot. They'll fight their way through it. But by gee, they're not happy with having to do it, and they know they didn't have to. They're worried about their kids. They're genuinely worried. Where does the world go from here? And I don't think the world knows, and Victoria certainly doesn't.
Health Minister Jenny Markakos has been stripped of responsibility over the program. It's now in the hands of the state's Attorney General.
Victoria has recorded its lowest jump in new coronavirus infections in more than 3 weeks, with 278 new cases. The number of active cases in the state has also dropped by 14 in the past 2 days to 7,866. Now, elsewhere, there are 291 in New South Wales, 9 in Queensland, 6 in South Australia, 3 in WA, 2 in the Northern Territory, 1 in Tasmania and none in the ACT. Now, since the start of the pandemic, 361 people have died, the majority of whom were Victorians. While it seems Melbourne's Stage 4 lockdown is working, there are now concerns for regional areas where cases have almost tripled in the past 3 weeks. There are nearly 500 cases across regional Victoria. 176 of those are in Geelong, 23 in Ballarat and 51 in Bendigo. 11 new testing sites will be set up in the regions.
There is widespread concern too for residents in Sydney's southwest and western suburbs after a number of cases prompted a COVID health alert. Today's Lara Vella is at a drive-through testing clinic in Auburn for us this morning. Lara, residents are being encouraged to come forward for testing there, right?
Yeah, that is certainly right, Carl. This is just one of dozens of pop-up testing clinics right across our southwest and western suburbs this morning. As you say, this one in Auburn, following those strong words from the New South Wales Premier saying that she is still worried about the risk of community transmission, particularly in those areas. And overnight, we've got a third case of a worker testing positive at Liverpool Hospital. But the one that is the big concern is this second worker that's now tested positive at Dooley's Catholic Club at Lidcombe. That is a very, very popular venue in our western suburbs. Many, many people go there. And so now they are saying anyone that visited that venue between last Friday, August 7th, through to Saturday, Sunday and Monday, those specific times from New South Wales Health on your screen now, they are considered a close contact of those two workers. So in other words, they'll have to self-isolate for 14 days, get tested, and even if their result is negative, well, they'll still have to stay home for those 2 weeks, Carl. Now, we also have one more confirmed case of a school, student testing positive. This time it is once again in Sydney's inner east, St Vincent's College at Potts Point. That is just up the road from the very popular Apollo restaurant where you remember a couple of weeks ago we saw that large outbreak. That school today will be closed for deep cleaning following that confirmed case. Carl.
A lot happening. Lara Vella, thank you.
The Queensland and New South Wales border battle is heightening, with residents and essential workers who live on the border concerned they'll soon be locked out of the Sunshine State.
When you have a border closure, it affects so many people you don't intend to affect. And to the border communities on our southern border, can I apologise for any of the angst we've caused you? Please know this is to keep the community safe, and we're working every day to make sure that people who need to get through are doing it freely and to make sure we're keeping everybody safe.
Today, Queensland reporter Jessica Millwood is in Brisbane. And Jess, doctors say they're already facing delays with border exemptions.
That's right, Ali. A skin cancer specialist has spoken to us on the Today Show a short time ago, saying that the border closure is already having a significant impact on health access for those living on the border. He works at Mullumbimby, which is a town in northern New South Wales. He lives on the Gold Coast. He's having to cancel dozens of appointments every single day. He says if there is a hard border closure, this will simply get worse, and that he's now been waiting over a week for a medical exemption. Take a look.
The main issue is that by closing the border and preventing us from travelling across the border, you're limiting a significant arm of healthcare that services these communities outside of the travel bubble.
I can tell you there's a lot of confusion, a lot of concern with border residents this morning. We did ask the Health Minister's office for some clarification last night. I was hoping to bring that to Today Show viewers this morning, but as yet, we are yet to receive any response. Ali.
OK, Jess, thank you.
We have reached a milestone no one wanted to reach, with more than 1 million people out of a job for the first time in 22 years. And now we're learning the COVID unemployment hangover will be with us for years to come. Live to political reporter Fiona Willen, who's in Canberra for us. Fee, good morning. What is the warning?
Well, Alex, look, we knew things were going to be tough for a number of years, but we're starting to get a clearer picture of what that might look like. So The Australian is reporting the head of Treasury held a confidential briefing for business and union leaders. And in that briefing, he warned that unemployment is expected to remain above 6% for the next 4 or 5 years. So to put that in perspective, it was around 5% before the pandemic. So this means an extra 120,000 people in the jobs queue in the years ahead. Now, yesterday we learned the official unemployment rate reached 7.5%, although the actual rate is expected to be much higher than that. And the number of unemployed Australians climbed above 1 million for the first time. It's expected things will be even harder next month, because these figures are for July, before Victoria's stage 4 lockdown began. Alex.